She's the rock star. I draw so much inspiration from her work with kids. You know, you can't really teach swimming without a swimming pool, right? You need to be able to work with kids in the environment that you're teaching them about. And when we're learning digital citizenship and, you know, good safety practices, we need to learn these things in the environment where they're being practiced. And you need lots of practice. And you need guidance, too. I'll get into that a little bit later. Just to give you a little background on me, I've been doing this for, as Marianne said, about 15 years, but I was really fascinated by the internet, the advent of the World Wide Web, as a journalist when I saw the story that the New York Times broke about the first web browser. I thought, oh my gosh, I'd been studying CD-ROMs and, you know, looking into sort of seatback technology and aircraft because I was working for an in-flight magazine at that time, and this was huge. This was going to be a story I felt that was going to affect everything in life, from, you know, politics to education to the military to every single aspect of life, and it's kind of turned out to be true. The online safety field, I've begun to say, is really a little bit of a false field. Because really the internet and the web and social media and digital technologies are embedded in life more and more. So, and I'll get into that a little bit later, but what we had in the early days from about 1995 to 2000 was a whole lot of fear and speculation about what was going on with kids and digital media. We had no research. The first Youth Online Risk Study came out from the Crimes Against Children Research Center at the University of New Hampshire in 2000. So what happened in those first 5 years were sort of the development of nonprofit organizations by people who had, most of them were former attorneys or nonprofit executives. And they saw an opportunity, and I remember my business partner, my co-director at ConnectSafely.org, who also is a journalist, kind of based his first Safety on the Information Superhighway, remember that term, for the National Center for Missing and Exploited Children, on just talking to psychologists and researchers and parents, and there was a lot of common sense, and it was good solid stuff, and so the National Center took it up. He's now on the board of the National Center. But, you know, the first safety book came from a journalist. And schools were looking for information, and what they would naturally default to would be to go to law enforcement, right? Because the only people who really knew what was going on in terms of online risk were cops. They were experts in crime, and some of them were forensic cops. They could take apart computers, and they would go to chat rooms, and they were experienced in the most egregious crimes, right? Schools would call them for advice, and, you know, there was nobody else, so they would say yes. Some of them were FBI agents. This was before there were Internet Crimes Against Children task forces that have since formed in every state out of state attorney general's offices. And these guys would talk about crime. And that wasn't what the vast majority of young people in this country were experiencing, we found later from the data. And I think, you know, I have this theory that these extremely well-meaning people were coming from a place of kind of post-traumatic stress disorder, right? Some of them need counseling. It's required for some law enforcement people when they're dealing with these crimes because it's so disturbing. And these are the people who are doing internet safety nights in schools. They still are. And the message is be afraid, be very afraid. And this is not a healthy message for parents. And it's really, it doesn't help parent-child communication. It doesn't express anything about what kids are experiencing online. So I'll tell you a little bit more about what they are experiencing. But first, it really helps to kind of pull back and see where we are in history right now to get a little context. And this slide has way too much information on it. But what it says is that we are at a place maybe a little bit similar in, you know, sort of revolutionary nature to the Gutenberg Press, which led to the Renaissance and the Reformation, as we all know. We don't know what the next Reformation and Renaissance are going to look like in human history. But this is a huge media shift that we're experiencing from the mass media environment that we grew up in to a social media environment. Clay Shirky, who is a tech policy pundit and New York University professor, in a talk to the U.S. State Department a couple of years ago, said, "This moment we're living through is the largest increase in expressive capability in human history." And it, you know, it's kind of three revolutions wrapped up in one. Clay talked about how, you know, it's all media, both professionally produced and user-produced media, coming at us through the same pipeline or presented on the same platform all at once. We have to sift through all that. And it's multi-directional and multimedia and real time. And the third kind of revolutionary thing about it is it's social. Content is behavioral in a lot of ways. So what does all that mean? Well, in the 90s, that meant nobody knows you're a dog, right? There was a certain anonymity to internet use. People weren't really interacting with each other. They were interacting more with content. There were discussion boards. You know, there was sort of rough interactive communication, all text. So it was really hard to tell who you were talking to sometimes. But then Web 2.0 came along in the mid-2000s, and you know, you had in Slate magazine, it was declared, everybody knows you're a dog. And that's really kind of what we're experiencing now. That's our kids are socializing with their friends at school, basically. That's what's happening in Facebook. That's what's happening on the phones. It's a real name culture. Facebook sort of coined that term, and that's in fact what we're experiencing. But it's all also very, very new. We're really, the internet, Sherry Turkle at MIT said, we are really in its toddler phase, and we have a whole lot to learn about what it all means for all of us. We're working out the social norms of social media. The thousands of years of social norm development we've been doing in so-called real space, we are now transferring into a new kind of space for all kinds of things, from production to entertainment to academics to interaction and sociality. So a couple years ago, I had the honor of co-chairing the second national task force in the social media phase of the internet under the Obama administration, and we were trying to figure out, you know, it was a 150-page report that we sent to Congress, and we really didn't think too many people would read it, you know, maybe a few legislative aides, but so we thought the title's very important. So the title that we came up with was safety, Youth Safety on a Living Internet. We wanted to send a clear message to lawmakers that this is a living thing in a lot of ways. This is, you know, our production, our everyday life, our self-expression, our creativity. So much of our lives are expressed in real time, updated in real time, 24/7. And we're talking about a huge swath of humanity, right? There are like about 840 million people in Facebook now in every country in the world. And they are uploading 30 billion pieces of content every month. 30 billion pieces of content. The numbers that YouTube, I wish I had them at my fingertips. The YouTube numbers, the number of videos that are posted, you know, add up to more than all the production, television production since the beginning of TV in about a week, something like that. The numbers are absolutely extraordinary. So the properties of a living internet are probably summed up in, you know, the fact that content is social or behavioral, updated in real time by users. We all know it's mobile. In many countries, people are now jumping on the internet. I was in Kenya last fall. Mobile technology is really taking off in Kenya. It's an English-speaking country, and it's really kind of emulating India in a lot of ways, where mobile technology is huge. People bank with their phones. There's a whole sort of mobile infrastructure there for commerce, and so everything else kind of layers on top of that base that has been laid in India. And parents in India will save up a whole year's salary to get their kids a mobile phone so that they can go on Facebook. So there's, you know, so that they can have that kind of upward mobility that social media represents to people in the developing world. So it's a whole different kind of perspective than what we have here. There isn't quite as much fear around social media in some of these developing countries. And in effect, so for a huge swath of humanity, the internet is a platform of expression, but it also is kind of a mirror of all of human life, all the details of human life. And the implications of that are really fascinating to think about. And it is really important to point out that it is embedded in our lives. It's not something separate, layered on. People who grew up in the mass media environment tend to think, oh, this is a new thing I have to learn. Oh my God, you know, a new thing added to parenting, a new thing added to education. But it's really not. It's not that new. What's happening in Facebook is kind of the way we were when we were teenagers, more so than it is new. And so what that means is that the risk spectrum online really maps to the full risk spectrum offline. So you don't need a new kind of expertise to grasp the youth online risk. You need to talk to psychologists. You need to talk to child development experts. You need to talk to the people who get kids, teachers, and administrators. They're the ones who are the experts on what's happening in Facebook. They don't know it yet, but they need to know it. Their expertise really needs to be in this conversation. And I just really want to call out how completely individual social media is among adults and kids. Social media is not just social networking. Social media is what's on your phone, which is a full-blown supercomputer, you know, like 20 years ago. Everything's on that phone. It's games. It's what's happening in Xbox Live, the gaming community. It's also social network sites and virtual worlds and console games and handhelds and you name it. Really, music is social media because so much music is shared. It gives people a sense of identity and they're sharing who they are. Now, there are some things that are different now. And you know, some of this is expressed in newspaper headlines and TV stories. I call it the net effect, and it was neatly packaged by social media researcher Dana Boyd in her PhD dissertation that was published in early 2009. And we're familiar with a lot of these properties. Persistence and searchability is, you know, an internet that where it's hard to take things back. And what you post is searchable. So it's kind of good to know now that we can Google ourselves. We can Google our kids and find out kind of what their public image is. And we can do a little reputation management and help them be smart about what they post and how they represent themselves in this digital footprint that is really unavoidable. We all have digital footprints, whether we like it or not. And it almost doesn't pay not to be in Facebook, because if you're in Facebook, you have a little more control over what's being said about you. You can push back a little bit. And we can kind of keep an eye on our kids in Facebook. So there's some things to be said for, you know, gently, lightly keeping an eye on things. Scalability, you know, kids don't always think about the fact that what they're sharing can be seen by a lot of people who they don't know. Potentially, we can help them set their privacy settings. We can help them think about what they're posting. We really don't want to leave them on their own, right? Parents don't leave their kids on their own in real life to just fend for themselves and figure stuff out with absolutely no guidance. Well, they kind of need that guidance online too. And you know, there are other properties that I'm sure you're very familiar with that are good to be mindful about. A little bit of the youth risk research. started with the famous 1 in 5 kids are sexually solicited online. And that was, the primary author of that study was David Finkelhor at the University of New Hampshire. And then a new body of research began to emerge that we were able to get into that second national task force. The first one at the Harvard Berkman Center was kind of a settlement out of court between 49 state attorneys general and News Corp, which owned MySpace at that time. And I'll kind of get to the youth risk literature in a second. But the social media body of research that emerged a little later and is really getting rich and interesting was started by through a $50 million grant from the MacArthur Foundation. And they kind of kicked off the field, supporting the work of almost 24 researchers in what was called the Digital Youth Project. And those researchers were doing both qualitative and quantitative work looking at the home environment, how kids use technology at home, how they use technology at school, and how they use it in after-school programs. And one of the findings of this group of researchers was that there are two kinds of social networking or social media use. Friendship-driven is the one that we're all pretty familiar with. It's kind of hanging out with your friends and in the online environment, and that's about 84% of 15 to 25-year-old social networkers. The other part of social networking is really getting interesting. This is where young musicians, videographers, athletes, game designers, code writers, anime translators are getting feedback and context for their work, mentors, inspiration, healthy competition, and of course geography is not a factor anymore. So, you know, if we're writers, we know about writers' groups and how fabulous it is to read your stuff to colleagues and peers and get feedback. Well, that's the kind of thing that's happening with kids in all kinds of vertical interest communities online. So that kids can become professional in their fields before they even graduate from high school. And it's happening now. I read in the papers every now and then about kids who write apps for the Android platform. One kid in Texas got an app into his high school history class. It was a history education app. Another young person started a nonprofit organization that was all about educational apps for iPhones. And he had aggregated a whole bunch of really useful apps, both for school to parent or school to household communication, but also in school learning. Another young person from Toronto is a professional videographer, and he gets all kinds of amazing feedback for his video camera work online. So interest-driven social networking is a really exciting part of kids' lives now. And what this fantastic professor at Arizona State, James Paul G, says about our children is that we're growing a bunch of young people who see what they do as social and collaborative, part of joining communities. They function quite naturally in teams, what in the business world are called cross-functional teams, where everybody's an expert in something, but they know how to integrate their expertise with everybody else's, and they know how to use other people's expertise and knit it together with theirs so that they can pull off problem solving and find solutions in a pretty complex world. It's, you know, any chance you have to see this happening in your home or your school, it's a good idea to support that work, because this is a pretty crazy, unpredictable time in our history. Problem solving is really important. There's a guy at USC named John Seely Brown, used to be the director of Xerox PARC in Palo Alto, and he's an author and an educator himself. And Seely Brown said that, you know, education really needs to be more like whitewater rafting now than the steamship. You know, the education of the past was really, you know, you set a course and you move forward in a straight line for a very long time. It was all very predictable. And, you know, that's kind of the educational environment we grew up in, but, you know, it has been in place for quite a few hundred years. But now you really need to be ready for anything. We can't predict the future, and so we kind of have to problem solve quite spontaneously, like when you're in a whitewater kayak. And that was something, that was a really wonderful metaphor Celie Brown used in a keynote just on March 1st at the Digital Media and Learning Conference in San Francisco. Another thing the researchers found is that there's this progression to social networking that's really fantastic. You've got the hanging out piece, and that's very social, and there's lots of informal learning going on in that space. It's not a waste of time, far from it. But then what happens sometimes is some kids, they start kind of tinkering or messing around with media tools, or using media tools to mess around with, you know, writing and music and game design, maybe a little bit of code, and it's sort of a transitional phase that kind of eventually gets them ready for geeking out. And this is actually the title of their book. It's called Hanging Out, Messing Around, and Geeking Out, Kids Living and Learning in New Media. And it's an MIT Press book, and I recommend it to everybody, but it kind of aggregates all that 3 years of research by all those researchers. But this was sort of the key professional piece that really kind of launches them into life. So geeking out is really good. If you see it in any form, there's a child here at this school. I got to meet with a group of seventh graders the day before. Was it yesterday? Yeah. And we found out, this is something that his teacher didn't know, that he's really into sneakers. He really loves sneakers. Sneakers are like an art form, right? They're high tops and there are low tops and there are all kinds of different designs. And there's a whole community in YouTube of people, an interest community, who are really into sneakers, and they do unboxings. Because I asked him what the videos are of, just like, you know, why can't you do a still shot of a pair of sneakers? And he said, no, they do unboxings. And then he showed us an unboxing. And then I met his dad this morning. It was so fun to meet his dad, because I thought, how cool that he lets this child have this, what would seem to us maybe kind of a weird interest. And who knows where it's going, but, you know, that's geeking out. He's seriously geeking out, and it's kind of exciting. I think there are some skills going on there that will translate into something else. So, you know, just a little bit about the numbers. Social networking has kind of taken off. It's actually, our country's pretty saturated. You know, it's not growing in this country. We're probably going to stay at about 85% of 12 to 17-year-olds doing social networking. And, you know, wow, that's interesting. 15% aren't. That's interesting. What are they doing? And maybe, you know, some of them are rural. Maybe some of them don't have broadband, and it's kind of hard to do social networking. But when I was in Kenya, I talked to a young man. You know, in India, they don't have smartphones. They don't have iPhones or Androids or, I'm not thinking of the right words, but, you know, the special kind of screen. They have feature phones. And they're doing, this young man from Democratic Republic of Congo who was at the meeting was doing YouTube and Facebook on his feature phone. And that's how they're using social media in India, too. So you don't need a fancy computer. And don't tell your kids I said that, because they probably would object to that. But so texting is huge. We know that. It's actually a little bit higher and more popular than social networking. That's now pretty much the number one social media tool. And it's really good to remember that when you hear outrageous numbers like 3,000 texts a month, you know, if you sort of divide that into days, maybe about 100 texts a day. And it's not as outrageous as you think when you consider that each text is only a tiny fragment of a conversation. And so it really takes, you know, a good 10 to 15 texts to have a decent conversation via cell phone. So, you know, that's maybe 4 or 5 conversations a day. That sort of puts things a little more into perspective. We don't have to be too nervous if we hear about 3,000 texts a month. And I just love this cartoon that, you know, now the dog eats my homework app. But it's sort of the, it illustrates how big apps are. There are 500,000 plus apps on the iPhone platform now, and there are over 400,000 for Android. Android has caught up really fast. So almost a million apps, and you know, the FTC is really looking into this, what apps are doing with the data on our phones, because a whole lot of our lives are stored on those phones, and what that means in terms of the Children's Online Privacy Protection Act, and advertising and geolocation technology, being able to pinpoint a child's physical location, what that means, that's really being looked into right now. But so you think about social networking, you think about texting. Now let's look at video games. 97% of U.S. 12 to 17-year-olds are engaged in video game play. And, you know, not much difference between boys and girls. I think that's kind of cool. I thought there was quite a gap. The girls are really into games, too. And it's partly because games are so social. You know, we're talking about all kinds of games. We're talking about sort of in-between time games, little tiny Tetris type games or Angry Birds that you do sort of in between things. And then there are the serious full immersion games like World of Warcraft. And you know, the list goes on forever. Social games in Facebook. I really love a startup that contacted us recently that is all about games between the generations. So instead of grandparents and grandkids just talking on the phone on a Sunday evening, they can play checkers together online. And it's really, you know, what you find in games is there's game chat, and it's a great way to catch up with people's lives when you're playing a game. A few interesting little statistics here. 76% of gaming teens play games with others at least some of the time. And I read in a fantastic book I'd recommend to all of you by Jane McGonigal, a game designer and PhD in something, psychology or sociology, called Reality's Broken. It's just all about games and how pervasive they are in our lives all around the world and why. And I won't try to go into why, but in this little talk, but she talks about how there was a piece of research done by a consortium of 8 universities in 4 countries, and it looked at the impact of games that encourage helping other gamers in them. And this happens in a lot of games where, you know, you join a guild in World of Warcraft and you help each other on a raid. There are all kinds of ways to help people in games. Well, this research piece found that those who played those games were more prone to helping people in real life, not just friends and relatives, but even strangers. So games have an influence on real life. It isn't entirely separate. Remember, it's embedded in life. And also, 44% report playing games where they learn about a problem in society. So there's a whole lot of connection between real life and games. And I've pulled some other kind of interesting stuff to play with and think about in Jane McGonigal's book. So really, what our children are doing, what all gamers are doing, is intuitively, intelligently seeking happiness. This is kind of a theme of her book. She quotes author Eric Weiner in saying that our happiness is completely and utterly intertwined with other people. It's a noun, not a noun or a verb, it's a conjunction, connective tissue. We're seeing all kinds of research about the impact of our social networks, not online, but our social networks in life on our well-being, how they improve our well-being. So there's a lot of research right now. You'll be seeing more and more about the power for good of this connectivity. Social good, personal good, etc. And then she also worked with this Czech American psychologist to kind of define what happiness is, and I think it's probably really close to what our founding fathers were talking about. Intense, optimistic engagement with the world and people around us when we are completely activated as human beings. And it's easier to get that in a game, it's more predictable to be able to get that in a game, but it's really wonderful to think about moving that into real life more and more and using games to do that. There's a sociologist, named Martha Beck, who wrote a different book, and she kind of studies how things work with animals and people who work with animals. And she came up with this Greek word neoteny when she was kind of watching how monkeys interact. She was watching young monkeys and their playfulness and what they were doing when she was very close to them in, I think, Botswana, in a park that sort of doesn't really keep the animals separate from the humans. And she said that neoteny, which is a Greek word, neo means new and tenes means stretch. And these young monkeys would really try to test their capability. They even tested themselves in to see whether or not they could touch her, whether they would sort of come up to her and touch her, and that became sort of a game. And you know that there's a lot of courage involved in that, and it kind of pushes their limits, right? Well, when she studied this, she discovered that the difference between monkeys and human beings is that human beings never outgrow that neoteny. We never stop wanting to stretch and test our capability and move forward. And that is very closely linked to play. We do that very naturally in play. And then another really wonderful guru is Stuart Brown. I don't know if you ever heard him on NPR. He's a psychiatrist who started the National Institute for Play. And he, his first encounter with it was when he talked to this guy who shot up a university campus in Texas. This is sort of before my time, so it's probably before everybody's time here. But he interviewed the guy, and then he was asked by the court to interview other convicted murderers in the prison. And he interviewed all of them, and what he found, the only thing that they had in common is that when they were children, they had a play deficit in their lives. They hadn't had a chance to play. And he really came to the understanding that play is absolutely essential for healthy human development and brain development. And then he, you know, a few years later, he was up in the Arctic Circle and he observed this amazing development between a polar bear and some huskies. And I don't know why, I can't remember why he was up there, but there was a world-class photographer there. And they observed this polar bear approaching the huskies who were chained up. They were sitting ducks. He was in a predatory stare fixing on the huskies. They were gonna be dinner. And this one husky, you can see in the second photograph, she was still chained up. She approached him with a kind of playful attitude and completely disarmed him. They sort of moved into a playful dance, and you can see in the third, where the arrow is, the third photo, that the polar bear had his mouth around her neck. He could have killed her instantly there. But they ended up kind of, you know, after this little playful dance, in a kind of hug. I guess that's a bear hug. So cute. And then he just left, and nobody got hurt. And the next night, what's so extraordinary is he came back. He came back to play some more. And again, nobody was hurt. So I don't know, I guess he got his food some other way. But I thought about that. I was listening to this interview as he was describing this, and you know what? There's a power imbalance in bullying. There's that's one of the key, like, three pieces of the definition of bullying, is a power differential and poor imbalance. And here we have with a polar bear and a husky, a total power imbalance, and I thought maybe play is the answer to bullying. Bullying is something we've been dealing with since probably the beginning of humanity, right? We're not going to fix it anytime soon, but maybe we need to think more about the role of play as a protective factor. there's a lot of other stuff going on in play too, in video games and in regular real life games, strategy and negotiation and problem solving. And you know, they're, because they're negotiating, they're learning social norms, they're learning how to function well together in community, they're setting up rules, and they're doing all of this collaboratively. So there's some powerful learning going on in games, in play, on the playground, in a virtual world, all these spaces. And it's really needed in this whitewater kayaking kind of learning environment that we're now in, like it or not. And there's a wonderful way that I just learned from a professor in the UK named Stephen Heppel. He teaches at the University of Bournemouth, but he travels all around the world and designs schools. He's designed schools in China. He's designed schools up in the northern Norway, and there's that chain of islands, isolated schools, urban schools. And I just happened upon this interview that he did about parents and games. And what he said was that we can increase our children's learning in games. If they insist on playing video games, we can make it more substantive if we turn it into an experiential learning experience. Experiential learning is done when you have the experience, but that's only about half of it. The other half is the reflection on what you learn and the articulation of that. So that's why, you know, teachers, they take kids on field trips and then they come back and they have a class discussion or they write an essay about the experience. Well, that kind of locks in the learning of that experience. Well, we can do that with our kids' video game play, Stephen Heppel said. We can talk with our kids, sit next to them, watch what's on the screen, ask them why they make certain decisions, not to the point where we're just incredibly annoying and they're all the time, you know? But just, you know, and lots of times they come to you, right? Hey mom, hey dad, look what I did. Look what I built in Minecraft, or look what I did, you know, look at this igloo, look at this stuff I bought in Club Penguin, or they want to share stuff with us. They want us to know about their accomplishments. Well, that's an experiential learning opportunity. Now, a little bit, I hope I don't bore you to tears, but this is sort of the youth online risk research. Let's do a little myth busting here, okay? This was the first task force I sat on, the one that the state attorneys general sort of set up with News Corp at the Harvard Berkman Center for Internet and American Life. And their findings, there were some key findings. What they did was ask us to do a complete review of the youth online risk literature from 2000 to through 2008. So it was really a huge accomplishment. Everything in, you know, North America and a little bit in the UK. There's an amazing group of researchers called EU Kids Online based in London. It's another whole thing, 25,000 kids in 23 EU countries interviewed for that study. But this lit review was a huge accomplishment because it kind of put to rest some American fears and some myths that had developed. First of all, we kind of were treating young people online as an undifferentiated mass of young people. And what we learned was that not all kids are equally at risk. It's really the kids who are most at risk offline, what we call at-risk youth, who are most at risk online, especially of the, you know, the predator thing that has gotten so much news coverage. But and we also found that predation is not the most common risk. In fact, it's highly unlikely that any child will encounter anybody close to a predator. You would think otherwise from reading the news, but it's really important. I can speak with absolute authority as a journalist and tell you that it is journalists' jobs to report the airline crashes and not the safe landings. You know, it is our job to report news, and an airline crash is news and a safe landing simply is not. And what our children are doing online is not news. It's good. It's mostly good. there are some kids make some terrible mistakes, and it's very, very sad. We saw what happened with the kid at Rutgers. What he did would not cause most, Robbie I'm talking about, would not cause a suicide in the vast majority of cases. It's just so horrible and tragic that in that case, we still don't know if what he did actually caused that Tyler Clementi to jump off the bridge, but that was unfortunately news. But suicide prevention experts tell us that the causes of suicide are many. It's very complex, and it would almost never be a single act of social aggression. So, and I think it's also really good to know that it's a child's psychosocial makeup and home and school environments that are better predictors of online risk than any technology a child uses. So it's what's going on in a kid's head and the surrounding environment, wherever a child moves, that is really what kind of defines what he's going to experience online. So it's the values of the household that he lives in. It's what's being modeled for him at home and school. It's his situation with his peers, how well he's getting along, that really determines his well-being online as well as offline. Right, because online is embedded in real life. And then we also, you know, that what we had was 49 state attorneys general prescribing before there was any kind of diagnosis. And their prescription for child online safety was age verification. At that time, it was sequester adults from kids, right? It's sort of assuming that adults too were an undifferentiated mass and that they were all potential predators and all children were all potential victims, right? So you separate them out and leave the kids alone. What do you have then? That's crazy. That's Lord of the Flies, right? Kids need a little adult supervision every now and then. So that was kind of a crazy prescription. But so one of our conclusions was that no single technology is going to keep kids safe. And in fact, it can often give parents a false sense of security, right? We have to be developing a filter between their ears at all times, from the moment they pick up a connected device. We need to be working on the filter between their ears. This was also in the Lit Review, but it was also published 2 years before that in Archives of Pediatrics, that young people who engage in aggressive behavior online are more than twice as likely to be victimized online. So aggressive behavior is highly risky, whether we're talking about predation or bullying or anything else. So, you know, we have peer-reviewed literature that says basically, that backs up what we all know, that what goes around comes around, right? So now we're thinking that maybe good citizenship, kindness, is what will keep children safe online. Yeah.
Does that include standing up for oneself and retaliating? Let's say in
standing
Minecraft,
up for oneself and retaliating, those can be two different things.
Could be, or they could be one and the same. Let's say in Minecraft, if a child builds a village and somebody comes in and destroys their village. If they go after that person or report them to the proper authorities, is that considered this type of behavior?
If a kid wipes out your building in Minecraft, that would be considered aggressive behavior,
no,
for sure.
One who got victimized.
Yeah. Well, that's a really complicated question, and it's very contextual, right?
Yes.
I think probably the best thing to do would be to sit down with both kids. That's probably not bullying, and I'll get into the definition in a second. But that's a little act of social aggression, and so in that case, probably the teacher and the two kids sit down and talk about what just happened and why. And if it was just sort of a momentary fit of anger, that's probably the best way to handle that and try to get to the bottom of that anger. Are you having a really, really bad day? do you want to say you're sorry? You know, that kind of thing. I am not a child development expert. I would defer to the educators in the room about the best way to handle that. But I think it really is important to think about the context of what happens in a situation like that. It wouldn't be that different from what might happen on a playground.
But what if the individual who is responsible for wiping out one's town is known for doing such things? That this is not a one-off event. This is pretty much the way they play.
I think the school knows who those kids are, generally, and maybe the parents do too. And that is definitely something that everybody needs to be talking about. I'm not going to give you a blanket answer for a hypothetical situation because I don't think there really is a blanket answer for anything like that.
I know, Ann, you had mentioned the other day in your talk with teachers. I'm Beth Brennan. For those who don't know me, I'm the early childhood director down at Children's Hospital. Oftentimes you mentioned that the bully is often been bullied themselves or has something going on, and we definitely see that in children in the context to what you refer to. And I think oftentimes it does require that next step where you really sit down, and that's what you were talking about in the citizenship part and really trying to negotiate more things through. I have found oftentimes what parents view as bullying behavior by another child is really just the fact that they don't know how to interact socially, so they go to their go-to, which is aggression, whereas other kids may go to victimization or to, you know, playing a different role. So it's almost addressing those behaviors in all situations, and also refer to the fact as parents and educators and people who are following our children, not to take a snippet of one incident and blow it out of proportion, but to look at, historically speaking, you know, where your children are coming from, you know, raising poor kids in today's era too. You know, I oftentimes may see a text from a friend or something that, you know, happened, a reaction my daughter had to another friend that I think is you know, almost mean-spirited, and I have to remember that that is just an evolution, one snippet in an evolution of a whole series of conversations, and to make sure I'm not jumping as a parent to a conclusion based on, you know, something said in a text, because there is a lot of emotionality or an action like that that, you know, we're putting a judgment to it that we need to get context. So I think in that situation, I think it would be awesome if the educator or could sit down with the two children and say, gee, you know, we're working through this, and do you feel that that was, you know, that was appropriate? Why did you do that? And, you know, how do you think that makes the other person feel? And, you know, what would you do in a situation if that child retaliated? How would that make you feel? And really try to have that conversation. I think that's what the important thing I'm learning as you've been speaking is that we need to use the same set of skill sets we use with children in socialization, in play situations, on playgrounds, and in classrooms, and in interactions, in worlds that we may not be comfortable as parents knowing, but if we take it as citizenship, I think it's a really cool premise, and it's a great place. Like, you often hear our computer technology department speaking to kids in ways I would never think of about their reactions to one another in the gaming world when I happen to walk by. It's quite exciting. And I think they are doing that, and it's worth, if a situation like that happened, to bring it to the attention of either the teacher or the administrator, because I think if we start having these kinds of dialogues with children in ways that we would if we got pushed off a playground, that it might help children to see that it's the same values being discussed, but in a different way.
Yeah,
that helps them.
Yeah, I think that's right.
Just wanted to add one thing. I'm Anna Daniele. I actually work as a psychotherapist, and I do deal with bullying in different forms and shapes. And just one thing to add, what you said, it's absolutely the parallel thing. What I notice happens with the online cyberbullying is that there's additional layer of shame added to it because
so visible.
Exactly, because basically, it's public, and the kids do not know who saw what, and they don't know who.
So tough.
And yes, it's in that sense, it's probably one aspect of it. I mean, there's different nuances, but this is the biggest aspect of
emotions are staying safe.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Basically,
maybe augmented a little bit or amplified a little bit.
Yes, exactly. So it's just.
Which means that we have to really treat it sensitively. It's so important because we can make things much worse if we overreact or reach in, you know, the big mother gorilla arm and try to fix it based on seeing one thing. That can really be a huge mistake and very humiliating for children, or marginalizing a child who's been targeted even further. Tell me if it's too much. I'll try to go through these slides fairly quickly, but I think it really, if you need to go, let me know, or if you want to ask more questions. I do think it is important to point out how really intelligent our children are in a lot of ways. Certainly the media, the news media, don't give them the credit that they're due, and they deserve a lot of respect for the way they intelligently work things out, and I think they need some space to work things out sometimes. The problem is, what's so hard for us adults is now all of adolescent behavior and the minutiae of their everyday lives is so visible to us. And very often what we're reacting to is the visibility more than the behavior. The behaviors aren't that different from adolescent behavior when we were kids, but it is now much more visible. And so I think we kind of need to, as Rosalind Wiseman, the author of Queen Bees and Wannabes, often says in her wisdom, you know, don't go in with guns blazing. Go in with the idea that there are other perspectives and talk things out. So their intelligence, you know, Professor Larry Rosen, psychologist at University of California, said that for all internet problems, the vast majority of teens either had appropriate reactions or ignored the behavior. And that's, you know, whether it's sexual solicitation or harassment or exposure to unwanted materials. How does he define appropriate reactions? Telling the person to stop, blocking the person from commenting on their profile, removing themselves from the situation by logging off or reporting the incident to an adult or the site. So, you know, 92%, 90%, 94%. So we're talking about some pretty smart kids. And then this is the director of the Crimes Against Children Research Center at UNH saying there is no evidence predators are stalking or abducting unsuspecting victims based on information they posted in social sites. So posting information online alone is not a risk predictor. And as far as sexual exploitation overall, clear downward trend. The latest data takes us through 2008. These are government figures. And the latest data, it went down 6% even more. So overall, we have 58% decline in child sexual exploitation. You never hear that in the news, right? It's extraordinary. In fact, if you look at all the social problem indicators involving young people, and I've seen this data both from Christopher Ferguson at Texas A&M and David Finkelhor at University of New Hampshire. You know, teen pregnancy, smoking, alcohol and drug abuse, suicides, teen intercourse, dropout rates, fighting in schools, you name it, suicidal thoughts, they're all down. And some of these social problems are down significantly since around 93, 95. So David has said in a talk that he coined the term juvenoia. And this is a guy whose research has been really grossly misrepresented in the news media since the first youth online risk study in 2000. He said that we are probably gonna be looking back on this time as a time of tremendous amelioration or improvement of the social problem indicators involving youth. And it's not because of the internet. The internet isn't the cause for that, but we have solid data that shows that the internet is not creating additional risk or enhancing risk in any way. A little bit about cyberbullying. I think it's important always to remember, and I was so proud of Lady Gaga when she got up on the stage and very with with real dignity, and she was very articulate. We kind of expected this glitzy show, and she just was very thoughtful when she launched her foundation. She acknowledged that bullies are hurting inside too. She was bullied as a child. At one point she was stuffed into a trash can by some kids, and I think it's because she was different. She was a very creative kid, probably very sensitive, and so she was targeted. When kids sort of stick out, they're highly individual. I have a little more data on how kids perceive kids get targeted, but bullying is a problem for the bullies too, and we kind of forget that. And she showed that she had learned that, because when she first launched her foundation, partly in reaction to the suicide of one of her fans, she was feeling very punitive about bullies, until she started talking with the researchers and really came to understand that bullying is a painful thing for everybody involved, including the bystanders or the observers. We're learning a whole lot more about bullying and cyberbullying, especially in the past year. There's been a lot of pressure from the media because the media is getting it so badly wrong. So we're getting a better sense of definition. We're finding out that cyberbullying is a subset of bullying. It's not really any different. It's just kind of the electronic version or expression of bullying behavior. We're also finding out that cyberbullying is this giant umbrella that people throw everything under. Everything, you know, from a prank that goes wrong to an argument between two people where there's no power imbalance at all, just an argument or conflict, that's not bullying. When, you know, there's a little bit of mean gossip, another thing that seems to be a part of growing up and very often a part of adult behavior too is social aggression or social rivalry. You know, especially when teenagers are trying to figure out the kind of social pecking order that they're a part of and where they are in it, that isn't necessarily bullying. But people are beginning to call everything that's a little bit mean bullying. And so surveys that find that bullying is skyrocketing are not really using the definition very well. And so we have much higher numbers than is really the case. So it's not an epidemic if 21% of kids have ever experienced cyberbullying. But we do know that it's highly underreported, and there are a lot of reasons for that, but one of the reasons is that kids are afraid that adults will make things worse. That if they go to the principal or go to the headmaster or just tell any adult, that there will be overreaction, other kids will find out, and they'll get marginalized even more. And that's a serious interest, because we do screw up. We don't handle things really well. The sensitivities are very, very high among kids, we know. The other thing that we're learning is that what you see on a Facebook page is just the tip of the iceberg, or a freeze frame in a strong, you know, sort of a pattern of action and reaction. So it's really important not to react from a single incident or something that you see on a single page or in a profile or a status update. When we overreact, we sort of add to the drama that's already there. And it's a really good idea to kind of get to the bottom of things and quietly, calmly investigate what happened. Very often, you know, bullies and targets can change hats in an instant, and very often what you see online is a victim's reaction to something that happened offline, and so the victim seems to be a bully when the victim is just kind of defending him or herself. So we really kind of have to get to the bottom of things before we make any decisions or call in the cops or something. Call the other parent. The survey from young people, I think it was a survey of about 12,000 kids in 25 schools across the country, and they turned up some interesting things to think about. We're not too surprised that bullying is has the greatest effects at the middle school level, grades 6 through 8. But look at what bullies focus on from kids' perspective. A whole lot to do with looks. 55%, you know, sort of facial looks, 37% body shape. Race comes in a fairly distant third, race and ethnicity, then sexual orientation. We have to take care of our LGBT youth because they do get targeted a lot in bullying because they stand out. Same thing with learning disabled kids and kids who are visibly struggling or vulnerable. We really have to take care of those kids. It was interesting that family income showed up in the data. I think the sort of the looks thing is really important to focus on, maybe to help children understand that, you know, diversity is good, that we all look different, and we can just respect each other more and model that in our homes and schools. Young people also talk about the idea that it really helps just to be listened to. It helps more when they're talking with peers and friends than it does to talk with adults, but when adults do kick in, they can be very helpful when children really want to talk with adults. Stan Davis and Cherise Nixon, the authors of this study, said that our students report that asking for and getting emotional support and a sense of connection has helped them the most among all the strategies we compared. And then there's the social norms research, which is a new body of research that is really shedding light on how to deal with bullying. There are two professors up at Hobart and William Smith who did a 3-year study of, I think, 6 New Jersey schools. And they went into each school and helped the school conduct a survey of bullying behaviors among students in that school. So each school sort of had a sense of ownership about what's happening here. And what all the surveys found is that the vast majority of kids don't engage in bullying behavior. They're basically respectful to one another. And they also found that when you get the facts out, when you help people understand exactly what's happening, that change perception changes behavior. And so, you know, the little red line is, you know, this is impossible to see, but the red line represents actual bullying behavior, and the blue line represents perception. So when people realized that people weren't bullying that much, bullying behavior went down. That's the social norms research. So it's good to get the facts out. So this is why behavior being such a key issue in social media and finding that aggressive behavior increases risk, it was very clear to our task force that digital citizenship really is key to online safety and really needs to be the focus going forward. And so we recommended that we make it a national priority to teach digital citizenship or foster it pre-K through 12 right in the core curriculum. And since you can't really teach swimming without a swimming pool, it really helps to provide digital environments in school in which we can model and practice good citizenship, online as well as offline, in the classroom, in a wiki, in a game environment, wherever we conduct ourselves. And so that's the infrastructure, that environment where behavior happens, whether, you know, regardless of what that environment is, and then it gives us a chance to practice good behavior and working together and collaboration, and then guidance is the teacher's role. So it really helps to get social media in school so that kids practice using social media effectively and constructively successfully with the guidance of a teacher, so that schools do for new media what they've been doing for hundreds of years with traditional media. But it's not rocket science, right? Doesn't need hours of professional development. It's just learning how to be good to one another in a new environment. And it's not just netiquette. You know, I think if we just talk about being nice to each other, being polite, we're sort of trivializing something that's a lot more powerful. We really need to be thinking about civic engagement online as well as offline. So it's not just clicktivism, right? It's not just something that you like, but that's something you're fully engaged in and you see yourself as an active participant. It is norms of behavior. It is changing social norms. And then, we often think about citizenship as rights and responsibilities, and we need to kind of work those out, what they are online as well as offline. And it is a sense of belonging, but it's also these three literacies. It's like literacy is really a three-legged stool now. You can't have media literacy without technical literacy, because media and technology are inseparable now. And you need social literacy because media are social now. So you need three literacies in order to really effectively use media. So I'm a journalist. I'm not a child development specialist. I'm not a psychologist, but I'm a parent and I've read a lot of research, and these are the tips that seem to just sort of emerge from the readings about the best way to keep our children safe online. It's really helpful to talk with them, kind of work from the kid out, from the inside out, rather than extrapolating from the headlines what our children's experiences are online. But also give them some space. I'm seeing some research now that kids are now moving into Twitter because so many parents are in Facebook. They do kind of need their own spaces to interact without worrying about parents constantly looking over their shoulders. And more so as they grow up. A lot of this data is really kind of from maybe late elementary on. I'm not talking about early childhood education. Think about what we're modeling for them. You know, they do learn a whole lot about life and socializing from their parents and their teachers and the other adults who are big influences in their lives. And we really still are big influences in their lives. The research shows that too. And let them know we're there for them. And I think it's always a good idea to replace fear with curiosity, especially nowadays. If we're like deer in the headlights and try to ban things, then kids have a million workarounds. It's so easy to, if they don't set up an account on Facebook, they can set up an account somewhere else. They can go underground, right? So it's really better to kind of keep the lines of communication open and help them figure out how to navigate this space rather than ban things so that they go underground and they lose our influence over that experience. There's a certain amount of common sense there. And then, there's been some really great research at the Harvard School of Education in online ethics, and one of the things that the researchers discovered is that young people have a real sense that they can't do anything about what happens online. They have a lack of efficacy or agency. And I think that's really the result of over a decade of saying, oh, all this media, it's just a waste of time, or it's trivial, or it's not meaningful. If parents sort of treat it that way, then kids respond that way. I heard kids in one class say that the number one safety risk is predators. Well, I asked them, none of them had any experience at all with anything remotely close to a predator, but they just heard that. They'd heard that in their homes, they'd heard that in the news. It was like a really big deal out there in the media, so, well, it must be true. And so that's, if they keep hearing that sort of trivializing message that their media, the stuff that they love, is inconsequential, at best a waste of time, or really possibly risky or dangerous, then they're going to feel that way about it. So I think we're really moving into a period of, instead of control, a period of agency. The model needs to be agency. Empowering them to use their media intelligently and wisely as active participants in a really highly participatory, digitally informed world, a networked world. And I think it really helps all of us if we see that this is much more about our humanity than about our technology. So this is from John Seely Brown. He formerly ran Xerox PARC in Palo Alto, and now he's a special assistant to the provost of University of Southern California. He's an author and an educator, and he just said in a keynote on March 1st that the most unsafe thing you could do is not let your kids start to understand how to interact with the world. And one of the ways that they're interacting with the world is through new media. So thank you very much for listening to all the research. If you have any questions, feel free to go. I know I've taken up a lot of your time, so really appreciate that. I'm happy to have a rich discussion if you'd like.